this is the question I think we're going to be asking for the next 6 months. Isn't whether the Canucks are going to make the playoffs. No. After that Toronto loss, it's going to be, can we afford to buy out both Oliver Ekman-Larsson and Quinn Hughes?
Okay, we get a lot of shots. Everybody come to the net. We just have to get more and more pucks to the net.
I'm about to listen to Pucks on Net.
We used to talk about it in Vancouver, getting pucks on net.
Pucks on net.
What were you saying about putting pucks on net?
This is JT Miller with the Vancouver Canucks, and you're listening to Pucks on Net.
Pucks on net and driving and making a hard night on them.
Speaking of screwing things up, live on tape from a myriad of locations, this is Pucks on Net, a Vancouver hockey podcast riddled with rampant speculation without sources. A somewhat last-minute satellite hot stove edition of the podcast coming at you. My name is Ryan Shepp. I'm going to be your host for the evening. Three quick tidbits. Patreon.com/PucksOnNet if you want to support us monetarily. Pledge a couple of bucks.
Couple of dollars.
YouTube.com/PucksOnNet if you only listen to the audio version of this podcast and you want a little more insight. We put every video on there, video podcast and some other content. And finally, we're doing it. The people have spoken. The emails would not stop. More shirts are on the way. Orders have been placed.
A lot of people came to... Listen, it was a long weekend. I was working. I was accosted by a numerous amount of listeners. I'm just kidding. I wasn't accosted. But a lot of people have been talking about they wanted shirts. They weren't able to get shirts, probably because Ryan is hoarding them all for his friends and family who aren't paying for these shirts. He just wants to be the guy. And I'm like, Ryan, my parents took out a second mortgage to pay for these shirts. And he's like, I don't care. I don't care. This is the problem. It's you and international students. No, just kidding.
I'm at a point now. I want to live like a rich guy where it's like the best few weeks or the few weeks after Christmas where every day it's a brand new pair of socks.
Yes.
That's how I'm living. Every day it's a brand new Pucks on Net shirt. Old one gets thrown out the door into the alley out back. But yeah, shirts are in. Another 20 are coming. No smalls, medium, large, extra large, 2XL. You better email pucksonetca@gmail.com ASAP, because I think we already sold three today. And,
wait, what? Oh my God. We've already pre-sold three? Jesus.
Yeah. So let's head on over the Ironworkers Memorial Bridge to the village of Deep Cove.
It's unlivable. It's unlivable. I'm kidding.
He is my notorious cyber bully from 2016 to 2020. Mr. Arash Bamarzadeh. Arash, how are you?
You know what? It was a good run. It was a good run while it lasted.
Five solid years of cyberbullying.
We lost a game. And you know what? Oh. I just think, like, it really sucks to be officially eliminated from the postseason contention mathematically. Because if I've known anything in this last weekend, there are people who are really good with numbers, and they can see stuff that we can't see. And they're just automatically right, so we should give them the hubaloo. I'm doing great. I had a good long weekend with my dad. We worked. I went to a bird hospital just to get our little budgie checked, and he's fine.
Just to take it all in.
Yeah, to take it all in, man. But he's okay. He just had like a little poopy problem. We're doing that. So I'm sorry for people who are following me on Twitter. I'm sorry I missed the Toronto Maple Leafs game. I know probably people were expecting some dank ass memes, but I'm sure Ryan and the rest of our loyal Canucks Twitter people, I'm sure Boothie had some great stuff as well.
No Gita this week. A last minute
she got really
absence.
Fucking she just had too good of a time at Diwali. I'm not even saying she's not even hungover. It's just she had so much joy in her heart celebrating Diwali that she said, you know what, the last thing I need is to spend time with two baby men who don't even understand what PDO is. No, I'm just kidding. She didn't say that. She
asked a great question, though, and I wanted to lead off. We were talking about some other things.
Go for it.
She's like, this is my question for the podcast. If you and your sibling played in the NHL, which one plays for the Vancouver Canucks?
I do.
Now, a little backstory here, because every time a famous playing combo played for the Canucks.
Okay.
Played in the NHL. The lesser one played for the Canucks. Your Steve Kariyas, your Fedorovs,
Sean
Prongers.
Yeah.
And then even currently with Quinn Hughes, it's like, yeah, he's great. But Jack Hughes.
Oh, come on. They're all like very equally good. Even Luke, like give Luke a little bit of time. He's playing very Quinn-esque.
So that being said, Arash, would you be out of your, if your siblings played in the NHL? Including
well, this,
yourself.
This is the thing. I have two
would
older
you be
brothers.
Playing for the Canucks?
I have two older brothers. This is the thing. I feel like I would have a very like Claude Lemieux-like career in which I would come to Vancouver as a visitor and demolish them and then be like, man, you guys really should sign me. And then the fan base goes from hating me to when July 1st comes and I sign with Vancouver and I'm like, I'm home. Everyone's like, yeah, we've loved you all along. That's me. My oldest brother's favorite player was Jimmy Waite. I think that's a goalie,
that's
right?
That's not the question we're asking.
No,
here.
No, I know his favorite. Oh my God. Ryan's such a, oh, Ryan, I'm saying because he adored goalies. So he'd be a goalie for the Canucks and I would fucking shell him. I'd get him pulled and I'd be like, yeah, that's what you fucking get. And then my middle brother, he never cared for hockey. So I just assumed like he would have a really good career in Sweden.
Yeah. He'd be like a Philip Holm approach, a brief moment in the show.
Like, no. I think like a dude who's like really talented, but he's very much like, this is a job for me and not a passion. You know, I'm trying to remember who's like a really good example of that.
I feel like with my sister, based on the accomplishments alone in society's eyes, I would be on the Vancouver Canucks.
Where would your sister be?
What's a celebrated franchise?
I don't know. Celebrated franchise? Like define celebrated.
I feel like she would be on the Blackhawks before everything got awful.
Your sister would have saved the city of Chicago. That's what you're trying to say.
She's got three Stanley Cup rings, and I had a nice run in the bubble once.
You had such a good run in the bubble, Ryan. That's what I'm talking about.
Mom, Dad, don't forget about that. Mom. It's not all about owning homes and having them almost paid off by your 40th birthday.
I don't know. I kind of feel like it'd be cool to own like a centimeter of land in this city. That'd be nice. Ryan, let's jump right in. Canucks.
Well, hang on.
What?
There's so much to jump into. Okay. Which Western Conference team are we going to talk about?
We're not an Edmonton Oilers podcast, even though, the Edmonton Oilers have brought Connor McDavid's favorite fourth grade teacher on. I don't know. Well, let's talk about Canucks and then we'll talk about Oilers.
But sure.
Let's
start with the Canucks.
So, like, okay, so they on this road swing, they go 2-1. They drop a game against Toronto in which I think both of us can agree that was simultaneously Elias Pettersson, Quinn Hughes, and Thatcher Demko's worst games of the season. Uncharacteristic about Quinn Hughes. He was getting pressured by Toronto forecheckers. He was trying to do drop passes on the power play. Couldn't kind of figure that out. A lot of pressure there. Elias Pettersson, good game against Montreal, but just really was a little invisible and struggling against Toronto. And then, yeah, Thatcher Demko isn't an invincible brick wall. And then that caused an enjoyable night on Canucks Twitter with certain people being vindicated of their forever rankings of certain players and the regression to the mean, as some people in the PDO world might call it. Yeah.
I don't know what those acronyms are, but yeah. It was... I don't know who Dom is, and it's fine that he got a lot of retweets last night. So that's cool. Good for him. Social media clout is cool. I'm sure he does great things. He only has one photo on Twitter, which you can, for those in the online dating community, that's everything you got to know about that.
Yeah. Here's the thing. So like, you know, when people engage the Vancouver market like that, everyone's just playing. Everyone's like poking the bear. And it's fun, right? The problem, and I'm going to throw back to you, Ryan, in 2 seconds. The problem I have is that we all know people.
20 minutes later.
I've known people like this my entire life, like how you know, people, especially in the analytics community, and Dom Decision, listen, does a lot of work, does a lot of good stuff on The Athletic. And for as much as we'd like to joke around, I think the hockey community outside of Steve Simmons and Jim, what, Matheson, and
I was gonna say, who's Mark, the guy that
yeah, who's Mark Spector? I mean, everyone's dunking on Mark Spector. Even Jay Woodcroft even had one last snipe on him. The problem I have with the analytics based community and the way we're thinking is that there's anytime you challenge someone in the analytics community about being like, well, you said that this blank thing would happen and it didn't. They're going to be like, well, you know, numbers and math and these things are tough and it's an outlier, whatever. And then when the one thing they say is going to happen happens for one game, they will be like, I am the truth teller. I am the God. Told you so. How stupid are you guys? And then the next 81 games, the thing that they say is going to happen doesn't. And they're like, well, that's the wonderful world of analytics. And that's a wonderful world of advanced stats. And where some, Ryan, have you ever encountered someone where it's like they just want to be right and you can't engage with them?
I mean, that's everybody.
I mean, no. There's some people who genuinely like I was like that when I was younger, and I don't feel like I'm that too much now, where I feel like, hey, I'm really into having my mind changed. And not only am I into having my mind changed, but I'm not going to put up a giant brick wall for you to climb over. I'm like, yo, like, you don't have to try too hard to change my mind. Like, let's have an open discussion about it. Have you encountered people like that?
Yeah, generally anybody on the internet wants to be correct, and the majority of people don't. And it's sports, mm-hmm. and people want to be right. And like, I find the dumbest thing in the world is like, I find all aspects of this ranking of a defenseman to be pretty petty, mm-hmm. from all sides. And it's sports. Yeah. It's unpredictable. It's chaos. And I'm like, I don't get the purpose of keeping receipts or freezing cold takes or that anything. Like, yeah, okay, if you're like, the Griffin Reinhardt trade is going to reshape the Oilers and they're going to be a juggernaut for 20 years, that's bad.
Yeah.
But if you're like, oh, I don't know if Matt Barzell's really that good, when you're like 17 and then like 20 years later, like, look at this idiot. Like, oh, that's right. Just cheesy bullshit to me. I think that all sides of this debate are kind of showing their asses a bit.
Yeah.
And it's all about it's not about whether you're right or wrong. It's how you carry yourself. And I think that's something everybody should take a little lesson from last few weeks.
Yeah. So like my thing, I'm coming down. Have you read Moneyball? And not to say all analytics just comes back to Moneyball, but I think that's like the best reference.
You bring up Moneyball about 65 times a year.
We all love Moneyball. We all love that movie. It's fantastic. I made the dire mistake of telling Katie that we should watch Moneyball because you'd love it. And no, I was wrong. the thing is, the way I'm looking at it is like you not to harp on, we're going to get back into the Canucks bandwagon, but the issue I'm having with analytics is like, even within the specter of saying, okay, we're going to create a team that's going to analytically be sound through finding players of undervalued on undervalued contract and contracts, and then rejigging what proper value can look like in a new NHL. So no longer looking and saying like, this guy's 6'6", he's big, sign him. This guy is speedy, sign him, and trying to make things to be a bit more thing. My problem is, you know, we're looking at stuff like this to be like the Bible. Like it's the thing that you look at and you say, this is the key to forever lasting success. Or at least if you want to be really good, you have to key into this and it's going to take you to the promised land. And I'll look at something like Moneyball where it'll even talk about sample sizes where, and you know, a Moneyball team goes into the postseason and that's where the Oakland Athletics go and they get beaten in a 7-game series. And it's like, so do we have so in this small sample size, like, do we have to start looking at analytics and being like, okay, over a regular, you can use analytics to create like a regular season team. That's
you
great.
Just answered your own question. You can't look at, you can only look at analytics so much until your sample size is complete and you have a conclusion to everything, so to your experiment.
What I want to follow up and ask is that if you present that to someone who's analytically based, and I'm sure we have a lot of listeners and everything, I'm just really curious, like, okay, you got here, you got to the playoffs, what now? You know,
that's the chaos. And, like, and the majority of people that look at sports analytically absolutely hate the playoffs.
So then,
because there's so many intangibles in the playoffs and so many other factors and injury make up this swirling cosmos of BS, which I think if you have an analytical mind or analytical approach mm-hmm. to a sport, like the thing you dislike the most is that when the regular season is over and there's a clear cut best and worst team, mm-hmm. you know, the St. Louis Blues come and win the Stanley Cup, or the Capitals do, or the eighth seed LA Kings do. Like, mm-hmm. it's just, you can break it down all you want, but there's so many X factors in sports, especially hockey, that, like, you basically, if you're going to look at it that way, you can't look at it until, like, you know, once everything is resolved. It's a very difficult way to fit sports observation and coverage into a little bucket.
Yeah, and just the reason I bring it up is, like, there's so many people that are getting jobs and opportunities because they're analytically based and they've done really great jobs and have done a lot of great work, but I'm like, you get to the postseason and then all the numbers don't mean anything. Well, I mean, they mean
something. What Arash is saying, quote Arash on this, anything happens when you get in. End quote.
Oh, don't do that. I mean, I'm really curious. Like, it's been something that we've all been talking about the last week, and I guess being on Twitter too much, it's kind of ramped me up. But it's like, yeah, I would love to. I'm pro analytics. I just think, like, you know, there's something to be said about looking at a player over a 82 game season and then looking at a player before a really important game and asking him, how are you doing? Like, the human mm-hmm. factor and everything of being like,
oh, absolutely.
You know, I thought about taking my bird to the bird hospital during that, the Canucks Maple Leafs game. And I'm like, yeah, like, how do you gauge that within a player's mindset of, yeah, they're not a robot.
You inject the bird full of Toradol and you say, suck it up and let's win this one.
Does the bird have a bloody sock?
He's just picking. Ah, it's a shame. What a great sports story had to happen to the worst possible person.
Oh my God. Pedro Martinez has thrown an elderly bird down onto the ground. That's your baseball reference. Right?
Let's segue into what the Canucks have done this last week. You know, I keep, again, this is a very strange phenomenon. The Canucks are good. The Canucks are consistent. The Canucks play well. They're structured and they have four lines and all that jazz. Mm-hmm. I keep looking at games of this is going to be the test. The Dallas Stars game, that's the test. They shut them out. They completely hamper their defense, their offense into nothing.
Yeah.
And we still go, yeah, but that Leafs game, that's going to be the real test. So it's like we're gonna look at these. We're not gonna believe it until the playoffs are here. We're not gonna believe it until they are mathematically in the playoffs, and that's fine. That's how we're all gonna do it. But I watched the Oilers, I watched the Toronto Maple Leafs play the Calgary Flames on the Friday night. Mm-hmm. I was watching that while I was making dinner. You know, I had it on. Absolutely horrendous game, offensively and defensively, and goaltending wise from all teams in that game. Just awful.
Right.
And you know, the Maple Leafs bottom six, the Maple Leafs goaltending, the Maple Leafs defense is questioned and ridiculed, tarred and feathered in Maple Leaf Square, and everybody is just like, you know, you want to talk analytical eye, everybody is ripping them to shreds, magnifying glass, etc.
Yeah.
So watching the Canucks game against the Maple Leafs, it was like the first period was like everything is going the Canucks way, and it has been, and that's great. Score the goals, they get two on the power play, and they keep getting power plays. And that's one thing I like about the team right now is that they can generate a lot of penalties. This was not game management. This was not ticky-tacky. They were generating a lot of power plays. Around that time, it looked as if either the Canucks started playing in quicksand or they were playing hungover, or the Maple Leafs were like, we need to have the defensive game of our lives. Mm-hmm. And I can't tell if it was the Canucks just laying an egg or if it was the Maple Leafs saying, we need to win tonight. We need to play the most, like, we need to not take our foot off the gas. We can't do anything stupid.
Right.
And it worked. So that kind of had me a little perplexed into what this team is. And then you go into Montreal the next day, 24 hours later, with your backup goalie, and they beat them 5-2, like you should beat, like a good team should beat the Montreal Canadiens.
Yeah.
So in my conclusion, Arash, everything's fine.
Yeah, I look at I look at even the Montreal game when it was starting out, and it was like, like there, I don't know how crazy hot and heavy things on the plane really got on the plane, as we saw with Andre Kuzmenko after the game, doing great stuff. When I look at the Toronto game, I just think they just had a bad game. That was just, I don't know what happened.
Those happen.
It wasn't like Toronto dominated and squeezed them. It's they had a bad game.
They probably got a little comfy too. There was 2 days off.
Yep.
You know, travel from Ottawa to Toronto isn't exactly a trek. So it's like,
yeah,
you know, I mean, it's the pretty American Canucks roster, but it's like you got some time to get high on the hog a bit and kind of be satisfied in how you're playing.
Yeah, 100%. In breaking that game down, yeah, I just felt like they had a bad game and their best players weren't their best players. I thought JT Miller was pretty good.
Yeah.
But overall, I just think they're core guys who we all expected. You know, on this road trip, we penciled in, okay, sure, East Coast media is going to know. It doesn't matter what we did against Montreal and Ottawa and like even against Dallas and stuff. No, it just matters Toronto. It's like the in-game. It's like the in-game playoffs. It's weird.
Arash, can you imagine there's Canucks fans like in the Air Canada or in Scotiabank Arena,
yeah,
and they're running down to the glass like, you guys, you gotta play better. The Hockey Writers Union is watching. They've got their votes. We need the Calder.
You guys don't understand.
We need the Norris.
We need to have the sweep. We currently have the Hart, the Norris, the Jack Adams, and the Vezina. We need the sweep. You guys don't understand. We don't even want a cup. We want the trophy sweep. We want Cuba Gooding Jr. to come out slightly drunk and just be like, oh, man, I love everyone here. I'm just giving out trophies. Moving on from that, congratulations, Toronto, on that win. I think it's unfair because everyone else got to play against Ryan Reeves, and we didn't. And I feel like if they had Ryan Reeves in the lineup, that's an easy W. Or else he's on the bench and he's going to do something. He would have done something. Oh, Ryan Reeves. Can you believe he's what, minus 11 now? He's two more years old.
And again, we'll talk about him and Sauce It or Toss It. I go on the record. I will, you know, from an analytical mind, I can't, like, I'm like laughing, but like, I quite like what Ryan Reeves brings to a modern NHL game. I just kind of wish he could bring it every night.
What do you mean?
But
like,
he can't.
What do you mean? What he brings to a modern NHL game? Like, he brings
He
could. Oh man, this man's a junkyard dog. Anything could happen with him.
I do kind of like the junkyard dog, or for our Always Sunny fans, it's a junkyard cat mindset.
Yeah.
I like a guy. I like the I'm all about the intimidation factor in hockey. It is something maybe utilized a bit more by Stanley Cup champions, but I just like watching him interact with his teammates, and like, he seems like a lively, upbeat, vocal guy. You know, that might not work for everybody, but if I was sitting on a bench with Ryan Reeves, I'd be like, it's good to have this guy on my team. I'm not saying his being a tough guy is going to fix anything, but he's my type of guy I'd want to play with.
Yeah, like he's fun to have around. I don't know if like he's going to help you win the cup, but if you want a dude to kind of like chill and have a beer with and be like, hey, this guy, you know, he must have some stories.
If you want to help a guy to help you win the cup, you get Patrick Maroon.
Yeah, I mean, he has three cups, and now he's in what, Minnesota, and he's like,
so this is fascinating, and it kind of blew my mind that they're doing this again. I saw this on Reddit last night, and they're basically saying that Ryan Reeves is in the almost exact situation he was in last year. And that was after an embarrassing showing in the playoffs, the Rangers were like, we're getting Ryan Reeves at any cost. Like, this is our guy.
That's the guy.
He plays 101 minutes with the New York Rangers, and they go, ah, shit, maybe this isn't our guy, and he's, you know,
it was the Tom Wilson deterrent, right? They had that thing where Tom Wilson was just like running rampant on the Rangers, and the Rangers like, man, we need a nuclear deterrent. The problem being that Tom Wilson can actually play like power play, like he's actually a power forward.
Well, also, Arash, you have the Rangers going in an upward trajectory, and you have the Washington Capitals going in a nosedive, and in between is the significance or the requirement of a Ryan Reeves. So they traded Ryan Reeves to Minnesota after 101 minutes played at the beginning of last season. So far, again, I don't know. It's Monday night. The Maple Leafs don't play till Tuesday or Wednesday, but he has played 105 minutes with the Toronto Maple Leafs right now, and he's getting healthy scratched.
It's crazy. Like I would love that amount of job security to know like people will continue to give me opportunities and mistakes just because like I'm big and I'm strong. They'll be like, yeah, it doesn't matter. We don't need it. It's just a nuclear deterrent. But you know what? I'm of the same ilk. Like someone gives you the contract, take it. Someone's offering you the money, take it. Do your best. That's all. That's literally all you owe them. So to Ryan Reeves, hell yeah, brother. Just keep on keeping on.
Vancouver Canucks have a very interesting week coming up.
Yeah, what's their schedule look like? They're back home. They have Horvat on Wednesday.
Wednesday night is the Horvat night. Then they play back to back. They go down the I-5. Oh, sorry. They go. They play Calgary.
Oh, okay.
And then the Kraken on Hockey Night in Canada. So, depending on who you ask, winnable games.
Yep. I mean, they're doing such a great like. They're doing this. Casey just they're handling DeSmith and Demko really well. I think it's shown that Casey DeSmith, man, what adequate backup goaltending can do, and it's not even like you need a dude coming in giving you 950. It's like, give me 905, man. Just give me 905. That's all we want. Arash, just give me 905.
You know what I love about Casey DeSmith right now? Is that in years past, there would be a dialogue or a discourse in the media, either for easy segments or easy time filler or easy phone boards to switch to light up. But there is no discussion about if there is a goalie controversy in Vancouver.
No, there's no.
And it shows that we have turned over a new leaf in this market. Nobody's talking about it. It's exactly what we've always wanted.
If I'm Elliot, like I'm literally just waking at 3 a.m. Toronto time. I'm waking up and just tweeting like goalie controversy in VCR. You know, like just fuck there. But yeah, so to wrap up just with Canucks stuff, listen, anytime anyone is asking me like, what do you think of the Canucks? Oh my God, are they going to get, you know, top seed, home ice advantage? Are they going to do this? I am being the most conservative in any bets with the Canucks in that I have been here before. I know what it feels like. I've been burned before. I hope them the best. They're playing good. Keep it going. We'll talk to me Jan 1. Talk to me literally 12/01 January 2024. Talk to me. I'll tell you how I feel about the Canucks. I asked my dad. I'm like, Dad, can you give me a really brief synopsis? And he said something really funny. He was like, no Stanley Cup winner, as far as I can recall, has ever went without losing at least one game. And he was just referring to Toronto. I was like, okay, yeah, sure. I mean, you're not wrong.
God damn it.
I'm like, God damn it, Dad. I love your sage-like wisdom. Keep going on the Canucks bandwagon. It's good.
Yeah, like you can look at it with a full heart and wide-eyed and bushy-tailed, but if you look at it with an analytical approach, it's like, man, there's no sample size. There's no previous example of the Canucks playing this well at this roster, so it's just like, enjoy it. But, you know, I don't think even the most overzealous of fans is ready to put a deposit down for playoff tickets
yet. Yeah, well, I think what they're doing, Ryan, is that they're just, like, it's all self-preservation, right? That's all it is.
Yeah, we all need it.
This
you don't get emotionally attached until the West Final.
Yeah, but it's also like Canucks fans, man. Like we are the most like sometimes we are not only the most vibrant and boisterous, but we're also incredibly fragile. Not in like our egos, but man, like you know how I describe it. How I always describe it is like if you break a vase enough, and you keep repairing it after a certain amount of time, it just becomes dust. You can't repair it anymore. Canucks fans the last 10 years. And even within their history, going back, we can go back to Keenan and...
Can you glue Gus? Can you glue dust?
No, but I assume you could take the dust and then kind of make it more into another clay type feature.
We're somewhere around
some
that.
Form of lobster-like creature. no, I just don't know. I have a soft spot for everyone here, everyone in the Canucks market in that. Like,
yeah,
man, I'm glad for everyone. I'm really glad for, I'll keep saying it. I'm really glad for the older crowd in terms of Canucks fans, people who deserve to see this team win. Younger fans, listen, we had 2011. That wasn't too far long ago. We had the bubble. There are people who have been here for a really long time wanting to. No. I said 20. No. It doesn't count. I said the year.
You did. You were talking You were referencing teams in the past. I'm going to leave this to the jury of the listeners. If you think we need to erase the chalkboard.
No, you can't you put it on me. I said the year. We had 2011. I didn't mention that certain set of games. I can refer to the year.
You're right. No, hang on. Arash? As your lawyer, drinking a 7% White Claw, I hear you. I exonerate you of all charges. You are clear to go.
Okay, thank God. I didn't mention that set of games. I didn't even mention the team out east.
Arash, I just said you're not guilty, and you keep telling me how you're not. You didn't commit any crimes. Walk out of the trial and just
dig up, stupid. okay, thank God. Okay, maybe that's fine.
Hang on. I also want to point out for those watching on YouTube, I am drinking a White Claw with the best koozie known to man.
Third Man Records koozie.
It's a boot.
It's a boot. Lovely. Well done. How much did that cost you?
Enough. Nice. I was talking to a listener of ours who's coming up here, and it's basically joke that everything in Canada is a 25% off sale. And I said, that's great, because when I go to the States, it's like everything is... plus mandatory 30% gratuity.
Dude, it's man, going down to the States now is painful. Like I really want even going to Trader Joe's, I'm like, God damn it. God damn it. Okay, fine. I'll get a fourth job.
Let's touch on this extremely quickly, as it's going to be the poll for everybody and it's going to be the open phone lines.
Yep.
Going to give you literally 20 seconds on this.
Okay, go for it.
Bo Horvat's
the return to Vancouver.
Is this the first return?
Yeah, I think so. Yes.
20 seconds. What happens?
They'll give him a round of applause. They'll have a video thing, and then after that, they'll boo him a couple times he touches the puck. That's it.
Sure, good enough for me. I was there the night that Ryan Kesler returned to Anaheim. I lost my voice booing him all night.
What does this count towards 20 seconds?
It's not coming off. I said it's a completely different situation, and it's going to be perfectly fine, but you are going to hear about this until 7:08 on Wednesday, yep. And I apologize on your behalf.
It's okay. I'll be the one. You'll have to mute me, because I'm going to be the one being like, Ryan, can you believe they were throwing Horvat jerseys on the ice, man? Oh, my God. We're both wrong.
Hey, 50 Horvat jerseys are 50% off at the Canucks team store.
Are they still? What jerseys were on sale at the team store, like on clearance?
You can get a reverse retro for 30% off, all sales final, and you can get Horvat for 50% off.
Oh, that's not too bad. Okay. All right. Well, if you got some money.
On that note, we're going to take a quick little break. We're going to come back with America's favorite game show, and the winner of this game show will win a trip to Canada, including a stay at the Inn at the Key in beautiful New Westminster.
Someone paid $9,000 not to come to New Westminster.
That on the other side of the break. All right, everybody, I want to thank you for joining us this far into the podcast. We hope you're enjoying the show. It's very important that we let you know that we had a lot of, these shirts are moving. We sold a lot of Pucks on Net shirts, and it's got to the point that we're going to have to put another order in. So if you want to get your order in, if you want to get a shirt, if you want to tell us your specific size, these are orders coming in right now. It is hot, it is heavy, it is fast, and it's furious. So make sure you get a hold of us. Send an email into pucksonnetca@gmail.com. Let us know your size, where your shipping address, or if you're local, and we can make it happen. Told you all about these shirts. These orders, they're not stopping. This is not a facade. These shirts here, everything you see here, this is all sold. We are sold out of everything but two smalls. So if you want a medium or a large or an extra large or a 2XL and you missed out on the last opportunity, now is your chance. We're only ordering 20 more though. So there's already a handful of people that want some of that 20. And now is your chance. If you missed out, let us know. Also, want to make sure you're following us on Twitter at PucksNetCA or PucksNetCA. If you want to support the show monetarily, you can head on over to patreon.com/PucksOnNet and pledge a couple of bucks. You can get all our vlogs, all our bonus content. Oh my God, these orders aren't stopping. We're only printing 20 more. You got to get in on this. Hang on, look at this. If you want a shirt, get it. But support us on Patreon, get access to all our bonus content. And if you don't want to support us monetarily, completely understand. YouTube.com/PucksOnNet. Subscribe, follow, enjoy, watch our content there. Also follow us on Instagram or TikTok. And just tell a friend. Get the word out. Grow a little footprint of this show here. Or most importantly, buy one of the new 20 shirts that we're going to get printed this week. Supplies, insanely limited. Priced to move. Shipping, very affordable. Email me wherever you are, and we'll get a shirt out to you. Now let's go back to the show. Sunset on Sunset. Sunset on Sunset. Sunset on Sunset. Speaking of 14 bedrooms, Arash, sauce it or toss it. The Edmonton Oilers, who are currently up 3-1 on the New York Islanders. Oh. The Oilers will be making a blockbuster trade by Christmas.
No, I am going to toss that. They don't have any assets to do a blockbuster trade. Like, what are they going to do? Yeah, here's our, we can trade a first, but we need to protect it. No, you don't get to protect it.
You're battling it out with San Jose.
Yeah, battling it out for San Jose. I don't know, man. They have to have they have to go at a crazy pace to make the playoffs. And I don't know. I think the narrative the narrative is going to quickly change from playoffs to like, hey, Draisaitl's 28 now and he has 1 year left. Mm-hmm. And then after that, McDavid has 2 years left. Like these are not RFA controlled kids anymore. Like you need to make a choice. And Ryan, to just wrap this part of sauce and toss it up. Connor McDavid, it's almost 10 years he's been. He's coming in.
They've done their time.
Like he's done his time, and now
he's Andy Dufresne.
It's going to turn into a legacy question where you're going down as probably, I'd say, like top three most talented players of all time, just in terms of how crazy he's impacted the game, how much of a cheat code he is. Are you going to end up being a guy? Now he's going to turn 27. Are you just going to end up being a guy who by age 28, 29, it's like, yeah, you're really good in the regular season, and you're really good on sports and highlight reels, and that was it. And that's your legacy. And then,
maybe,
you know, when you turn into a UFA, yeah, can you go and, you know, are you going to keep just re-signing in Edmonton and being really stubborn and saying, I want to make this work? And then
no,
Ken Holland's going to still be here, and then, you know, you're going to have all your substitute teachers, all your favorite substitute teachers being hired, and the girl that rejected you in high school, the Oilers are going to get her and be like, oh, listen, Connor, look who we ran into. Rebecca. Remember Rebecca? She likes you now. Like, you keep doing this nostalgic stuff. And then the Oilers, all they're doing right now is being like, oh, well, it's just a coincidence that we've hired all these people and that.
Let's talk about that after this. But it is not looking good, and they are not doing a good job at
hiding
making it look
any
better.
They're really not doing a great job hiding it.
Tossing a rash, the Kris Tanev will finally become a Toronto Maple Leaf this year.
I'm gonna toss it because I don't know if he'll want to go out east even more. I think the Zadorov thing. Did you hear the Zadorov thing?
Yeah, Dan Milstein's out causing a ruckus.
No. Dan Milstein said that, but then I think it was Jeff Merrick said that a player told him he heard a Maple Leaf player tell Nikita Zadorov on the ice, "Man, you're exactly what we need."
Yeah, one of them's going there because Ryan Reeves can't fight or play anymore.
Yeah, that's
so
true. But yeah, just a, yeah, I don't know. I'm holding out hope that Kris Tanev ends up being, the dad comes home finally. You know?
I'm just not, you know, as somebody that just saw the Hives last week and Guns N' Roses the last month, unlike you, Arash, I am not nostalgia pilled, so I don't feel that way. I'm not thirsty for Kris Tanev.
I'm not nostalgia pilled in the way that I'm like, oh, nostalgia is the thing. I'm like, dude.
You refer to him as dad.
Can we just put it? Well, yeah, he's dad, but that's the thing is that how do you mix up a roster that's doing really well without disturbing chemistry? Familiarity, like we talked about a couple weeks ago. It's like, man,
how many players on that roster? Well, okay.
Like, you know, it's plug and play, man. You know, you're getting, not only is it plug and play, but you're getting someone that's going to be a UFA that you can probably get at a cheaper price. And that if he wants to resign here, you'd be like, hey, listen, you can spend your 34 to 36 years on a 2-year deal playing with Quinn Hughes exclusively. You can just literally, that's you.
You know what's going to happen? Mm-hmm. He's going to be old Kris Tanev and come back and get hurt almost immediately.
Okay. Well, he's not going to get hurt because he's not doing puck retrievals like he always had to when he was a Canuck. When it was like Kris Tanev was our guy and he had to go, he had to move the puck out and he's like, oh, God damn it. Here comes Jamie Benn on the forecheck. Fuck.
I'm coming for you. Arash, speaking of monsters tormenting on the forecheck, sauce it or toss it, Arash. Alex Ovechkin is currently on pace for 25 goals this season, and he will not achieve it. Sauce it or toss it.
Of how many goals?
25 is what he's
tossing
on pace for.
Tossing it. Oh, my God. Come on. Just from a shot volume metric, like there's, I'm sure he's has a slump, and then there's gonna come a time when he's gonna score like 7 goals in 3 games, and then
let me tell you about this thing called PDO.
Yeah, it's the thing called PDO. have you heard about it before?
Ever?
You ever heard about it, guys? You ever heard about PDO? No, I'm gonna toss that. Hold on to it, man. He has an entire team that's like, we're not here to win.
Just
we're here to get you to 875.
We all are. We all want to be part of
it. We all want to be part of it.
Sauce it or toss it, Arash, benching Jonathan Huberdeau.
Sauce to the nth degree, man. Like, what do you, what more do you want to do? Like, what more do you owe Jonathan Huberdeau if you're the Calgary Flames at this point? You gave him the contract. You gave him the security. And it's not even like he's, you know, 0.75 points a game, or you know, like he's doing, you know, whatever. Oh, dude, the man's invisible. He's completely missing basic outlet passes. He's making Elias Lindholm's life fucking horrible in terms of just trying to keep up some form of offensive trajectory for a guy in his UFA year. Just bench him. And what else do you have to lose? You can't trade him. You can't waive him. Like you got to live with him. You guys gave him this crazy, crazy ass contract, and there's this discussion happened that. He hasn't adjusted to, it's different here than Florida. It's like, yeah, there's someone called reporters.
Expectations.
There's expectations. Sorry, man, that it's not like, oh.
People recognize you.
I've disappointed the 40 people in the stands tonight. Oh, no. How am I going to live with myself?
Sauce it or toss it, Arash. Ryan Reeves is the most useless player in the NHL.
Oh, useless? I would. I don't know.
I mean, Spencer Martin's in the league.
No, Spencer Martin's doing okay. I would. Useless. I would. Oh, that's such a tough word. I look at like someone like Mark Edward Vlasic, whom is very clearly like he's done, but he's burnt. Like he's the roast is now burning and almost caused a.
He's been here since then.
That's true. Point to the sign. Yeah, no, I don't know. Useless.
That's a great alternate for that question.
I don't know if it's useless, but I would say like like, what is it that you do here?
Thank you.
Like, I just don't know what, like, you're supposed to be the great negator, right? You're supposed to, and then, like, Bertuzzi gets runned. And then it's like, it's a shame I'm not playing right now, or I'm not on the ice, or else I would have made Nikita Zadorov stop hitting.
They take him out of the game, and the Leafs get in two fights with instigators. It is
really funny in that range, and like, basically like just being like, so you're supposed to be this thing that stops people from doing stuff, and then people go and do the thing. It's like this paradox. Yeah. Like, you know, I don't know. It's this paradox.
What are you doing here?
I don't know what you're doing.
He got that notoriety with that run with Vegas, mm-hmm. and he's just been coasting on it. He is nostalgia. Ryan Reeves is nostalgia for pre-pandemic good time vibes.
If you're here for pre-pandemic good time vibes, call Ryan Reeves. Make a good time roll, ladies and gentlemen.
Sausage or Toss and Arash, the Anaheim Ducks make the playoffs this season.
Toss, come on. Come on. Come on, Ryan.
Give me your Western Conference.
The entire West. Okay.
The eight teams.
I have to give you. I can give you the. Oh my god! I can't.
Vegas, Vancouver.
Vegas, Vancouver.
L.A.
Yeah, maybe L.A. We'll see how Cam Talbot goes off through the entire year. That's hard to like throw at me just at all at once, Ryan.
Okay. Well, you answered that. Let me look here. Here's what, if the playoffs started tomorrow, it'd be Vegas, Vancouver, LA, Anaheim and St. Louis would be in the wild card, and you have Dallas, Colorado, Winnipeg.
Okay. I don't think the Ducks are making, I don't know if the Jets will make it. So it's going to be Dallas. I'll say without saying like rankings, I'll do, Vegas, Dallas, Colorado. Oh, I almost want to be a really cheeky motherfucker and say the Coyotes.
I love the Coyotes.
I love what they're doing there. They just are. They
might be my favorite goalie in the league right now.
Connor Ingram?
No, Vemelka.
I think Connor Ingram. Well, they're both. I think they're platooning 1B.
They're incredible. He's incredible.
But yeah, I think they're in there. I don't know if the Ducks will make it up.
Okay, that's fair. And finally, Arash, sauce it or toss it. This might be a bit of word soup, so I will give you an explanation. Sauce it or toss it. Oliver Ekman-Larsson being that guy in the Connor Bedard highlight that will air during broadcast for 50,000 times. Now, I phrase it as that guy because if there's one goal we've seen a million times, it's Mario Lemieux scoring in the 91 Stanley Cup Final against the Minnesota Wild.
Mean that goal in all 72?
All when that,
you
that
all
one. But
squeeze a stick and you all pulled the trigger, and all I remember was sitting beside you. Ryan, you said you didn't give a fuck about hockey, and I never heard somebody say that before.
Winter time, losing in my grip on a fake cold war. Isn't it amazing what Sean Chambers couldn't accomplish when he had to defend against
Super
Mario?
No, Ryan, we're going to get copyright struck. Don't.
In the 1991 Stanley Cup Finals.
No, we're going to get copyright struck. No. We can't do the Tragically Hip. Come on.
Sauce it or toss it, Arash. OEL being the butt of a Connor Bedard goal, and we're going to see it for the rest of
toss,
our lives.
Toss, because he's going to play him like twice. Come on.
No, but we're going to see OEL at his least forever.
No.
Getting his ankles broken.
I don't think that. I'm going to big toss because I don't know. Who do I think Connor Bedard's going to do that to?
So you're saying it hasn't
Quinn
been...
Hughes is so bad and so overrated. But you know,
it'll be Tyler Myers.
Yeah, maybe no Tyler.
And he will literally break his ankle.
Tyler Myers would like kill Connor Bedard. Because that's just chaos. You know, shout out to Connor Bedard though. Kid's on a heater. Really sucks.
Six goals in eight games.
Something like that. It really sucks that he is on a historically bad team. Not historically bad team, but like they definitely did not design that team to be very successful outside of like highlighting one kid.
It's also a fundamentally bad organization.
Yeah, I know. It's fundamentally bad.
Speaking of Connor Bedard, Arash, there I was. Friday. I'm at whatever sporting goods store is at Westview Mall.
Yeah.
Get in. I'm going to buy some suspenders for some hockey pants, or trousers as I call them. And I walk in and I see a whole rack of Bedard Blackhawk Fanatics breakaway jerseys, the real shitty kind. Mm-hmm. Just disgusting. So if you are on the North Shore, if you go to Timeout Source for Sports down on Mountain Highway or that one up there, they have, if you need a Connor Bedard Blackhawks jersey, they have a lot of Connor Bedard Blackhawks jerseys.
I have a question for you. Like, when you watch Connor Bedard in Chicago, does it just not seem like, it just doesn't seem like this is a fit? Like when I'm watching the player, I don't look at him, and it's not screaming to me. And this is complete speculation. It's not screaming to me that he's loving, like he's really loving it. Like he loves it. He's in the NHL. He's having fun. But I'm not seeing like a Nail Yakupov. You know, he scores his third. And he's like, hell yeah, Chicago! I love the Bear. It's such a good show. Fucking every second counts. Let it rip. You know,
CM Punk.
CM Punk. Oh, man. Hey, how much did they have to pay Phil to do that?
To do what?
Did you not see Phil? He does the intro to the...
Oh, yeah. Probably not much. If I was a celebrity, if I was a famous person, and like if me, this person, was famous for something, I would devote... I would give a lot to the Canucks for free.
Yeah, that's true. I would just be around. Yeah, I'd just be like, hey, you guys need me to do an ad read?
Yeah, because like it's just like the old adage, like musicians want to be athletes and athletes want to be musicians.
Yes.
Like I'm sure if like they ask Punk, it's like, hey, do you want to? He's like, and this is a guy that's been on the world stage and on the biggest of stages and the brightest of mountains, and he's like, wait, you mean I get to be the voice before the Blackhawk games in house? Yeah,
sure,
I don't even need to pay me.
Yeah,
listener. Contributed, sauce it or toss it. Richard, Honeycutt in the Discord. Sauce it or toss it, Arash. Canucks will have home ice advantage in round one.
Oh.
This contradicts everything you said before this.
Oh, toss. No, I'm hedging all my bets. No, not hedging. That's not hedging. I am conservative. Wild card two. And anything more than wild card two, I will be so happy with. But wild card two. That's it. I'm not setting the bar any higher for this team. I'm saying, just get to wild card two. Great. You have a great start. Play 500 for the rest of the way. That's it.
They're in a great spot.
You're in a great spot. Just be 500. Be mid. Literally. MJF. Mid. That's what the Vancouver Canucks. Mid. The Cincinnati Reds. Mid.
They are. Well, no, they got some good pieces.
What happened to Joey Votto?
He's old.
Hey. Can we have a Shohei Ohtani update? What's happening?
I think the Cubs are looking to give him like a gajillion dollars, so Chicago again. But nothing, no updates yet. We will report back when they are made available.
Are we going to have like a breaking news one once the Mariners actually sign him? Do you want to have one where I'm like, I don't even know why, but sure.
I've thought about that, and like, I could tear up if they signed Shohei.
Why do you say that?
Just because he is such an impactful, incredible player, and he's like Sidney, he's like Connor McDavid. He is Connor McDavid because you have McDavid and you have Draisaitl and nobody else.
Okay.
And on the Los Angeles Angels, you have Ohtani, Mike Trout, nobody else. Just like they've wasted their years.
Because we're now an hour into the show, I'm really happy I can ask you this now because we don't really need to talk too much more about sports outside of Edmonton. Well, we didn't even talk about Edmonton.
We'll touch on it quick. Let's keep it
quick. But I'll talk to you about something real quick. If the Seattle Mariners sign Shohei Ohtani, like tomorrow,
yeah,
how well do the Mariners do the next year? Like, do they need to go out and still get a bunch of dudes?
They need a couple other pieces, but their outfield and potentially their pitching staff just, like, changes overnight. And you just add, like, you have your perennial three or four batter, and it's just, like, the load goes off of Julio's back and Cal Raleigh's back and Eugenio's back. And it's like nobody, they like guys can just like, I'm going to progress naturally instead of, oh my God, we have a huge hole in the outfield in our batting order and we all need to pick up the slack.
Gotcha. Okay.
So
love
it's
it.
Like go. Just insane depth.
Love it. Okay. Are we talking Edmonton before we go?
Yeah. Well, there's a few things to talk. Yeah. No, it's just, it's mainly Edmonton. Yeah. Okay. I feel okay. I feel bad for what they're going through. We're clearly seeing. I don't expect Ken Holland to finish the year here.
Really?
The press conference was so telling, and it's been picked apart. And but the contradicting lines where Ken Holland was like, Ken Holland was clearly speaking about, we've consulted with the vets about how things are going. Mm-hmm. They didn't necessarily consult with the vets. He was saying, like, hey, who do you want your coach to be? Because that's just an awful move, and it results in them, you know, running the asylum. But the fact that there was these kind of contradicting statements immediately after one another makes me think that it's this guy's team, this guy with a very innocuous name, Jeff Jackson, a fake name.
Jeff Jarrett.
Jeff Jarrett is running the team, and Ken Holland is just like, I'm going to do, you know, it's everything you hear from people in the know is Ken Holland is just going to do what he's got to do to round out and ride off into the sunset. People aren't talking about how Ken Holland needs to keep his job or Ken Holland needs to get this team into the playoffs. It's like Ken Holland's going to do what Ken Holland wants to do.
So,
and that's a concern.
So how I'm viewing it, like you look at Jeff Jackson. Is it Jeff Jackson here?
It is.
What a weird
It's that
name.
Futurama bit, Jim Johnson Jim, or John Jimothy, Jimson or
Jim,
whatever.
Jim, John, Jim, Jim, Jimenheimer, Slippy, Slimy, Slimy, Swanson, Swanson? Was it? No, look at the briefcase.
What?
Samsonite.
What did he do before he was president and CEO of Hockey Operations Arash?
I don't know.
He was Connor McDavid's agent.
Bingo. This is the thing. So it's they made up a title. So his title is CEO of Hockey Operations, and literally Ken Holland's title is President of Hockey Ops. So basically, what they're doing now is placating to Connor McDavid. That's the only thing they can do. They haven't surrounded him like they're trying to be like, hey, we have this great atmosphere. Like, yeah, you've been here 10 years and you haven't done shit. Outside of winning individual titles. But listen, we got your agent here now. We got Paul Coffey. He's really great. Look at Paul Coffey.
He's cool.
We got your junior coach. Your mom and your dad are running beverage and food. Like, I'm really cute. Like, they're literally placating Connor McDavid to that point where this is what I mentioned before in the pod. The narrative is really going to quickly change. Like, they have to decide on Draisaitl, and then after that season, like, man, then Connor's up. And if you think Connor's gonna look back and think, yeah man, we're still paying Evander Kane and Darnell Nurse is making this much, and like, man, I just, you know, it'd be cool if you plug and played me with, like, I'm trying to think of like a really, this is a really cool thing to have, Ryan. So let's just say in 2 years, or this season's done in 2 years after that, so let's say 2026, 2027, whatever. Tell in your short kind of memory, give me a really cool team to plop Connor McDavid onto. Like, let's say he gets an 8-year deal, $17 million per, or he gets a 7-year deal. He can't sign 8, sorry. But just plop him onto a team 2 years from now. What's a really sexy team?
The first thing that comes to mind is the Carolina Hurricanes. But they're kind of might be on their bubble, and their window might be kind of closing. Mm-hmm. Oh man, there's a guy climbing on the glass as the Oilers just beat the Islanders 4-1. He's not climbing on the ice though, but just the glass. A California team.
Okay. No,
really. And it's Anaheim.
It's Anaheim.
Because they have
what Gretz did. He's gonna do what fucking Wayne did. He's going to be like, you know what? I want the glitz and glamour. I'm going to take my ass down.
Glitz and glamour? Nobody knows the Ducks.
They will when Connor's there. They will when Connor's there. Like, listen, Trevor Zegras has 2 points in like 14 games, and now he's on the IR. Like,
and he's my least favorite player in the NHL.
Well, yeah, because he's too busy doing D'Amelio stuff. But I don't know. Yeah, I'm trying to think of like who has the best prospect pool in the NHL. Fuck, I wish Faber was here. Vamp for a second, Ryan. Vamp for a second. This is a really good segment.
Well, Rash, are you asking about a trade or him landing there as a UFA?
UFA, just like.
Well, then why do you need to think about
two years from now? I understand, Ryan, why you're thinking. Come on, let's go.
2 years from now, it still winds up being the Ducks because they have these guys like McTavish and Vertano that are just like blowing it up, and you add a guy like that into that spot, and it completely just, it's Shohei to the Mariners. Like, they have these bright spots, but it'll take them to the next level.
I have it.
It's not the Minnesota Wild. No.
Do you want to know what it is?
It's not the Seattle Kraken.
Not the Seattle Kraken. Do you know what it is?
Who is it?
Buffalo Sabres. No.
And that's how you
think about this.
That's
think
a
about
YouTube
this.
Exclusive
Owen Power,
segment right
Rasmus
there.
Allen.
No, it makes perfect sense.
Devin Levy.
Him playing with Tage Thompson.
Well, yeah, I mean, they have to. Skinner's probably going to be expired by then.
It's perfect.
That's so sexy. Oh my God.
They did it. They did it.
They did it. Buffalo's finally done it.
Buffalo, I'm coming for you, brother.
Oh.
One of my favorite clips, Jack Eichel drunk on Snapchat or Instagram or whatever, being like, Buffalo, I'm coming for you.
No, he's.
He knew he was going second overall.
Yeah, he knew he was going second overall. He's like, finally it happens. But he's like, yeah, I'm already. Dude, I had a heated driveway. I think they can move it. They'll just move my heated driveway from Edmonton to Buffalo.
Here's my quick talk on the Oilers.
Yeah.
You know, they won against the Kraken, who are a shining example of what happens when your PDO stops working for you. But they're going to rattle off five in a row. Like, they're on two in a row now. Like, they would have done it with Woodcroft. They wouldn't have done it with anybody. A team like this does not lose that hysterically bad. Mm-hmm. I think they're going to be in a world of hurt when the new coach buzz wears off. Every time a new coach comes into town, like, he's been there for a day. And he goes in and he goes, I'm trying to. It's like Boudreau did it in Vancouver. He shows up. He doesn't know half the guys' names or what they can do. And he's trying to learn names. Practice is just like a meet and greet.
Right.
It's the first day of university. You go into the game. You're playing a team against the Islanders, who the last home game, they're chanting Fire Lambert. Mm-hmm. So, like, you know, it's already working in their favor. But you get that new coach bump because the coach is not overthinking it, and he's just like, screw it, run the lines. Who's good? Anybody know who's good? Okay, go play more than the other guys. And it works for him. I've seen it. We've all seen it 1,000 times. This is going to wear off. There are bigger issues, and it's a dumb Band-Aid fix. And I feel like the fact that this was this Jackson's guy's, he was his guy for a while in Knoblauch. Oh crap.
Dude, to be fair, I can't, it's a very silly name. And I should probably remember. I almost called him Knob Launcher. I get to say a funny thing about someone's name. My name's Arash Mamarzadeh, okay? I fucking had to go through the ringer with that.
But Knoblauch comes in, and I heard a great point in another podcast. I forget what it was, but you know, there's been two head coach vacancies with the New York Rangers in his time being the head coach of Hartford. And they have passed on him twice. They went with Gerard Gerland, and they went with Peter Laviolette currently.
Right.
I'm not saying he's a bad coach, but I'm saying there is a team on the up and up that has passed on him twice.
That's a really good point.
And he is a esteemed, you know, he won in the OHL, he won in the WHL, no question about it. The WHL one is quite remarkable based on the Kootenay Ice roster he had, but it's not a good look. It's not the move you kind of make to pop a rating. It's not a Boudreau bump. It's suspect. It's a little questionable. And you bring in a guy like Paul Coffey, who's an advisor to the owner, bring him in as an assistant coach when he has zero NHL experience. Mm-hmm. It's just like the Habs did it a couple years ago, where they put them on the bench to kind of see what's working and what's not working.
Right, I remember that.
I can't remember who they did that with, but it's all moves that are like, we need to preserve Connor now to prevent the worst from 2 years ago.
I just
nice win on Monday, but I don't get it.
I just don't understand what the end goal is. Like, do you think this is very much like a Mick GM thing where it's like Connor's actually the GM where he has a lot of influence? Or is it literally these people like Occam's razor that literally these guys are like, if we make a really comfortable atmosphere, he'll want to stay. And that's
exactly that.
And it's just literally that is the dumbest. Like, dude, like you're not understanding that the narrative isn't about making it a nice place to play. The narrative is this man's goddamn legacy and what he wants his legacy to be. So you know how you change that? Tell Ken, hey, Ken, love ya, but we're going to move on from stuff and not have you as president of hockey ops with no power.
Yeah. It seems like they are yet... And what the hell do we know about how these conversations went? But I get the sense that it's like, we're bringing in your old agent as a president and CEO. Oh, we're bringing in your old coach. I feel like there's a group that are like, what do you think Connor would like?
Yeah.
And they're maybe not consulting with Connor. Well, maybe in this situation, you want to consult with Connor.
Didn't they have the thing where they said that they didn't consult with any of the players? And then within the first scrum today, Connor looked like kind of really fucking devastated. And he's like, yeah, we got a text.
And it just makes him look like a diva.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if it makes him look like a diva. I think it makes it look like, yeah, man, they fired the guy and brought in a guy I'm familiar with, sure, but they didn't even fucking tell me before they did it.
Yeah.
And I'm Connor fucking McDavid.
Yeah, he did. He that is how he pronounces his name.
Connor fucking
McDavid. In circles. Couple of quick things before we wrap it up.
Sir?
We need a news and notes theme song.
We do need a news and notes theme song. Like a
I'll reach out to Matt. Here's my quick news or notes that some have been debunked. The Canadiens' former team doctor, he is former David Mulder. He was asked what ended Carey Price's career. He had a meniscus injury, so we sent him to New York for an operation. And during it, the surgeon found that the femur had lost all of its cartilage. Oh. It was a surprise, and that's what ended his career. So just to think of the physical toll on the body is a little wild, and kind of makes sense how that. Like, yeah, his career's over. It just, like, came out of absolutely nowhere.
Yeah.
Logan Thompson, report came out from the Hockey News that the NHL wouldn't let him put a cancer ribbon on his helmet design for Hockey Fights Cancer Month. This is kind of brought up in the media this week, but it's like, yo, like, there's other teams. There are other goalies with cancer ribbons on their helmets right now. It could have just been a...
Who, like, I understand political things.
It's the dumbest thing.
Who's out here saying, I'm pro cancer, man? who's doing that? Who's on the other side of the pro cancer campaign that you're telling them? Like, come on, Jesus Christ.
And also the player that is currently eligible for the Hockey Hall of Fame with the most career points is Jeremy Roenick. Which I believe he has 1,100. I'm going to tell you that quote in just 1 second. I bring this up. He has 1,216 points in his career.
Did he ever win a cup?
No. He was too busy fishing his jock out of the rafters of the United Center.
Both my Stanley Cup rings stuck in my ear.
Pierre Turgeon held that title for over 10 years before he was inducted this year. The next two players behind Roenick with the most points that aren't in the Hall of Fame are Bernie Nichols and Vincent Damfus.
Okay.
And finally, on a very sad note, Philadelphia Flyers legend, everybody remembers him, a very memorable goalie from the 2000s, Roman Čechmánek, passed away over the weekend, only 52 years old, and very sadly, no cause of death was announced, so you kind of... assume the worst, but just a very sad
yeah,
event.
As a Philly fan, I'd just like to say, like, it's really unfortunate, and thoughts go out, thoughts and love and energy go out to his family. He was such a unique goalie, in that, he's huge, he has the size, and then his gaffes were more on the very loud side. But, like, when he was good, man, he was good. It's just
He was.
You know, sending love and energy.
Absolutely. Let's go into some questions here. We'll wrap up the podcast. Travis Elliott in the Discord asks, the Canucks are currently on pace to finish the season with a plus 180 goal differential. Mm-hmm. Given the high likelihood of regression, where in the schedule do you see this team experiencing some adversity, and do you think they will be able, they will have the ability to grind it out?
I mean, I have to look at the schedule. I just feel like there's going to come a stretch run where teams are going to be on heaters and they're going to run into goalies, and it's about how they deal with how they deal with the tough times and how they deal with the waves that are going to come. I would love it. Like if they do lose like 2-3 games in a row, we can see them not unraveling the way that they have years previous. And what I mean by that isn't just like they lose a game. I'm like, the way they lost games would be like, oh my crud. Like they're just, the dam is breaking and they're making the dumbest of simplest of mistakes. And JT Miller is punching the ice with his bare knuckles and Quinn is like cradled on the ground. So if they can be even consistent in their effort and their losses, Ryan, like, does that make sense?
Yeah.
Like lose, but lose in like a 3-2 way.
I've looked at a couple of stretches in the season, in the schedule this year. I could see hard times in April. In the first 2 weeks of the month, they play the Golden Knights twice, the Coyotes twice, the Kings, and the Oilers. So I would say your hard times are going to be there. And there could also be some hard times in December, actually.
All right, Dusty. Jesus Christ. Just say it again.
Baby.
There you go. Now do it again. Do it again.
They got them hard times coming up next month, baby. You might not know this, everybody, but go look at the hockey splits. And if you don't know what splits are, it's a term that doesn't make a lot of sense since you're a hockey fan, because it's going to tell you how the Canucks did against the New Jersey Devils, baby. And even without Jack Hughes, baby, the Devils have always, always been a punisher, if you will, to the Canucks. Every time the Canucks play the New Jersey Devils, they lose. They are 1-18-0 in the last 10 years of meetings, baby.
Yeah, but Dusty, you know, you have to understand. We're, you know, I have 7 Huskies, all bigger and trained. And I need to know if the American Dream can feed them. Is that what you're telling me?
What I'm telling you is in December, baby, next month, they're going to play the Calgary Flames on the 2nd, the Devils on the 5th, the 7th is the Minnesota Wild, and they're mild, baby, they are wild. Then they play the Carolina Hurricanes, the Tampa Bay Lightning, and the Cats, baby. That's a tough stretch.
I am so glad you finally got it. We're able to have a stretch run where you can do a voice. You're Dusty's so good. I'm so proud of you.
It's managed. It's tolerable.
You're doing great.
Speaking of tolerable people, big time film producer Matt Kerr, Kitsilano Kerr, Big Money Kerr. If PDO is why we have been so, quotes, lucky this season, was PDO not to blame for the decades of bullshit we have been through? I'll hang up and listen.
Oh, I don't know, Ryan. What do you think?
No. Yeah, I'll blame it on PDO. PDO is the cause and solution of all of our problems.
Thank you, PDO. Thank you so very, very much.
Much like Matt Damon getting bounced every night on Jimmy Kimmel Live, I got to acknowledge Mills for asking this question again, and he is aware of it. He goes, why isn't PDG on PP2?
Oh, I don't know, because I don't think that's his game. I don't think PDG is like, that's a guy that you're, I think he's a 5-on-5 player who works best as being an F1 on the forecheck. And, he makes shit happen around the ice. I think when stuff is stationary, I don't know if he's the best 5-on-4 player.
Yeah.
But yeah, sure. If there's an injury, sure. I don't give him time.
I have
Mills,
a, I have
this
a
is
going
to be my hill to die on.
Take it. I have a very spicy 5 minutes for paying segment idea.
We'll get to it.
Popped up earlier. I just remembered it now. And that's going to be, and it'll just be us looking at Daily Faceoff. Who has the best PP2 in the NHL right now?
Oh.
That's coming up on 5 minutes or paying. Oh. Let's rattle through these last questions. Annoying Canucks fan, JCoog88. Who's Mike from Surrey calling in at 6:50? Lol, JK. Appreciate that. It is me, fake name. Do you think this team, aka the current Canucks team, is good as the stats say, or is it a pipe dream?
See, like a lot of discussions, there's no middle. I think they're good. I think they will have tough times and they'll regress and whatever, but I don't think their regression is going to be like, hey, guess what? They're bottom five now. Like, they're not going to spike off. Like, they're a talented team. Thatcher Denko's healthy. They've addressed some things of the defense. We'll see what the Carson Soucy injury, like, what that'll do.
Yeah.
If Carson Soucy's out for any kind of stretch runs and stretch time, does Zadorov really now, like, does it really look like, really, you know, hey, this could look pretty good.
Could be spicy.
So, I don't know, man. I think they're a good team. I don't think they're a bottom dweller. I think they're better. They're a wild card team.
Arash, it falls into the mushy middle of what he was asking.
Yeah, I don't know. I think they're a little better than the mushy middle. Especially with like Quinn Hughes and Philip Hronek. That's why.
Yeah. Arash. I'm saying they fall in the mushy middle between the two options that were provided in the question.
Yes, they're in that. They're not in any of the extremes.
Commander Vander's left leg, who I delivered a shirt to this week. Wherefore art thou? That was his question. The answer is above the grounds of the old haunted Burger King.
Cute.
And this is a great question. And in the new year, I think question of the week and a little bit of a contest could return. This comes from Jake Ball Bolin on Twitter. Would you rather have dinner with Jay-Z or $500,000?
$500,000. What's Jay-Z going to do for me? What's Hove going to do for me? I love Hove, but he's too busy fucking being Beyonce's husband. Give me
He's
five.
Also a gajillionaire who's so disconnected like, from what, life. What are you going to talk
he's
about?
He's going to tell me, I'm going to ask him, Hovey baby, tell me, how do I become successful? Well, become a good rapper. Oh, shit. I'm not Jay-Z. What the fuck, you know, like what? Give me $500,000 to pay off the rest of my parents' fucking mortgage, and I don't know. We'll figure out what we'll do.
Is there a famous person that you would give up $500,000 for to have dinner with?
Oh. I don't know if $500,000. Like, someone I would pay a large amount of money to have dinner with? Yeah, there's one person.
Sure.
Albert Brooks. You know, in The Simpsons, there's the guy who does all the voice. There's like the iconic voices of like Hank Scorpio, the Monoxonil guy who gives Homer the thing. So he's been the voice. But he's a very famed American actor, kind of a pioneer of American comedy. And a lot of my favorite movies are his films. And he's just, I don't know, he's the guy I wanted to be pretty much growing up. Like, That's great. That's my nerdy choice.
It's a fair answer. I'd probably do Jack White, but then he would probably be like, oh, you gave up 500 grand, and he'd probably throw me a couple
and
bucks.
He'd be like, look out, man. We're going to 5 minutes for pain, man. Look out, man, because I'm the king. There you go, Ryan.
On that walk hard note, we'll wrap up the podcast there. We're going to go into 5 minutes for paying. And if you're still listening and you haven't yet, buy a shirt. They are going fast. And I'm not bullshitting you. They are not going to be sticking around. Christmas is right around the corner. So whether you have a significant other or a disapproving father that you need to buy a present for, nothing says love around the holidays than a cartoon crow on a back of a black t-shirt that's shooting a puck really hard.
Love it.
Good night, everybody.